So, anyways.
Please do what I am.
Definitely. Please, something else. Hi, welcome to Scoville Library. I'm Lawrence Davis Hollander. I'm the Adult Program Coordinator. And we're very happy to have here today Dr. Alan Price talking about a relatively local topic concerning Edith Wharton and Nancy Duryea, who we're to find much more about, very active in volunteerism in World War I era. For those of you not familiar, we have a lot of different kinds of programming here and a lot of historical. And we have a whole bunch coming up. Actually, one of our speakers, Jeffrey Rosano, is here. We'll be talking about David Ingalls, World War I flying ace, in a few weeks. That'll be on Sunday the 9th. And actually, Alan comes with his lovely wife, Irene, who's also a Wharton specialist. So you've got two Wharton specialists who are husband and wife team. And she's going to be speaking, what's the 22nd. November 22nd, on a slightly different Wharton subject about Wharton and her mentor, teacher, and secretary. And that promises to be a very interesting talk as well. And there'll actually be another one in our World War I series after New Year's, which will be Richard Boyle, who will be kind of dissecting Paths of Glory and talking about it some, both from a historical and art perspective. Tomorrow we are having Laura Arricchio, who just wrote a sort of definitive biography of Lafayette, Marquis de Lafayette, and that one is in collaboration with Oblong Books, and that's a collaboration we've had to bring a lot of authors, some local, but mostly from the outside. She's at the New School, Dean of the New School. She's coming up from New York. So if any of you are interested in that, I hope you come. We need some good attendance for that if we want to keep this relationship with Oblong and the publishers from New York. They like good audiences, good book sales, and it's kind of a rare opportunity for us to have this collaboration with Oblong Books. So if any of you can come tomorrow, I urge you to come to help boost our attendance as well. As it's going to be pretty interesting. This is a collaboration with the Salisbury Association Historical Society. We do a lot of programs together. Most of them originate from them with more local-based topics to Salisbury and so forth. And this one's a little bit different, but certainly locally based. And in a few weeks, November 15th, Peter Vermillier will be talking about the Salisbury Asylum and the New England Town Farm Movement. It's a very interesting piece of history that a lot of us are not familiar with. Anyway, to get to our speaker, Dr. Alan Price is the author of The End of the Age of Innocence, Edith Wharton and the First World War. And I suppose you could say not only is he a Wharton specialist, but he seems to be a World War I specialist on certain aspects, particularly his research concerns the 20,000 volunteers, American volunteers who went to Europe before the war started to work with different relief organizations, and I think he's focused on four different ones. He's also a humanities consultant for the exhibition The Volunteers, Americans Join World War I, which opens at the World War I Museum in Kansas City in April of 2005. So he lives locally around Great Barrington. So we're very pleased and honored to have him and eventually his wife as well. So thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, and one little note, these little raffles, they're not raffles, these little tickets. We've got a little rating system in those black boxes over there. Basically, there's three choices. One is, I loved it, let's have more like that. Number two is, not bad, I liked it. Three is, didn't work out at all for me. So we'd love your feedback. It's a quick way for us to serve it. There's also a little bit of material on the table there for some of the upcoming events. So you might want to grab that. So thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Price.
myself to the library and to Lawrence and to kind of get us on the map over here. And we're grateful to you. I was a college teacher for a number of years. The second most popular question was, when will this class be over? This script, reading through it, flipping through the slides, takes about 35 minutes. If I go off this script, it gets longer. So I want you to practice your hardest look. And when I move away from the script, give me that look so that I know to return and stay. And the second thing is that if I cannot be heard by the media or the listeners, just raise your hand or blurt out, "I can't hear you." And that's fine with me. The First World War, 1914 to 1918, is a huge and confusing topic. Heck, we don't even know what to call it. In older American libraries, which use the Dewey Decimal System of classification, and I can hear from your giggles that one of two of you know of it, it is sometimes listed under the European War, and sometimes it's listed under the Great War. Today, it's alternatively referred to as the First World War and World War I. Whatever we choose to call it, this four-year catastrophe ushered in the concept of total war into the 20th century, our century. The Great War began 100 years ago with what the historian Barbara Tuchman has taught us to call the Guns of August. Now, today is not a celebration, not even an observance. Those words are too lofty for 52 months of chaos and death. But we do acknowledge the centennial. And because some of my later remarks may seem lighthearted, I want to begin by reviewing the backdrop of the events of the First World War. First, the significant dates. Then there are the soul-numbing statistics. After September of 1914, the war settled down into a static affair that gave us a whole new vocabulary. The front, over the top, no man's land. She's good for many things, not by for mine. Estimates are that 20,000 American women went overseas to serve in private relief organizations before April of 1917. The American volunteers were apparently fascinated with uniforms. But this afternoon, I want to call your attention to two extraordinary women with close Berkshire ties. I want to tell the story of two important American war charities active in France during the war by concentrating on their leaders, Edith Wharton and Nina Duryea. Our progression begins with the novelist Edith Wharton. Here's a picture of her home, The Mount, in Lenox, Massachusetts. It's not a good picture, and I'm distressed because I have two trustees from The Mount sitting in the second row. But if you can squint, you should come and see The Mount and enjoy it, the gardens and the house itself. Now, Wharton built The Mount in 1902, and she and her husband lived there off and on until 1911. After 1907, Wharton began to spend more and more of her time in France, eventually leasing the apartment owned by George Vanderbilt in Paris. When the First World War broke out, Edith Wharton was a rich and successful author. She had already written many of her more popular books, including Ethan Frome and The House of Mirth. She had been living in France for 7 years, and she was planning to spend her summer and fall in England, where she was hoping to begin work on a long new novel. Her plans were interrupted, however, when the German army invaded Belgium and France and a general mobilization was declared. That meant that all of the men in France of military age were required to report to the army. Businesses and stores closed down all over Paris. Women who ordinarily worked in those places were suddenly out of work. The closures were especially hard on the women who worked in the couture houses, cutting and sewing. The French Red Cross asked Edith Wharton to help, and she did so by setting up a large sewing room where the unemployed workers could at least earn a living and keep themselves alive. The sewing room, which she established, eventually employed 60 women on a rotating basis. That was her first war charity. The second group that needed Wharton's help were the Belgian refugees. When the German army invaded Belgium, thousands of Belgian refugees headed south to Paris any way they could. The French government could barely keep up with its own homeless and refugees, so the poor Belgians were forced to find shelter in railroad stations, large sporting arenas, and on the streets. Recognizing the need, Wharton established her second charity called the American Hostels for Refugees. And here the word hostel simply means a temporary home. Soon, in addition to the French, the Belgian government asked her to assist in the housing and education of a group of Flemish refugee children soon to reach Paris. Wharton's biographer, Sherry Benstock, picks up the story. In April of 1915, when the Germans began a second wave of bombardments in western Belgium, and now we're also spraying deadly nerve gas on its fields and villages, the Belgian government asked if Wharton's war charities could provide housing for a number of children on short notice. Soon they asked if the charities could take an additional 100 nuns. And then they asked if they could take a colony of old women. And eventually, they needed space for 600 children found in the trenches and cellars of abandoned towns or picking up their food in the street like dogs. Edith and her younger friend, Elisina Tyler, formed the Children of Flanders Rescue Committee to meet the diverse needs. Under its auspices, they rented several residences near Paris and later two houses in Aromanche on the Normandy coast for those children suffering from anemia and tuberculosis. Eventually, the Children of Flanders occupied six houses, all directed by the Flemish Sisters of Charity. A teaching order, the nuns set up schools for the refugees in their care, and two lace-making schools were soon established. These gave the girls a chance to learn a trade and participate in the lace industry revival. Boys in another colony were taught agriculture, carpentry, and gardening. By January of 1917, the Children of Flanders Charity cared for nearly 1,000 people, including infants and infirm people in their 80s. In a memoir written almost 20 years after the war, Elisina Tyler remembered the circumstances that brought the first group of children to safety in 1915. At 4 o'clock in the morning on April 23rd, the Mother Superior of the Grand Hospice in Poperinge in Flanders opened her window to discover the convent garden filled with immobile shadows. British soldiers had left the wall and waited in silence until the clock sounded for morning prayers. Standing guard while the girls were hastily dressed in their Sunday clothes, the soldiers escorted them to an emergency train bound for Paris. Elisina herself first saw the girls lined up along the station quay at the Gare du Nord. Dressed in black, each clutching an umbrella, they looked like little widows. Elisina, the lady in charge, solved the problem of transporting them to the suburb of Sèvres, where they were to be housed, by asking the director of the Paris Municipal Police to lend her the tour buses that the Thomas Cook Agency had put at its disposition for the duration of the war. The procession to Sèvres included four buses filled with refugees, eight coal cars loaded with beds, mattresses, cooking utensils, and furniture. Now, Wharton had been told that the first group of 60 were scheduled to arrive in Paris on railroad flat cars within 24 hours. Could she help? What would you say? But you know, success, well, I should point out that some of these children are holding up pictures of their king, Albert, which if they were to have done that in occupied Belgium during the opening months of this war, would have had them severely punished, if not worse. Now, as I say, success in the refugee business can have surprising results. She barely settled the first 60 she was given when they sent her 200 more. When her book publisher in New York asked about progress on the manuscript, she'd promised it a year earlier, an exasperated Wharton replied, "For the present, there is too much to do for the unfortunate creatures all about one to think of literature." Now, knowing that these children would return to Belgium after the war, Wharton made sure that they would develop skills during their days, soon to be months, and then years, as refugees. The youngest children were taught in the Montessori system, brand new system of education. And some of you who are familiar with Montessori may recognize these tables and shapes. And all of the children from Dutch-speaking Flanders were taught the French language. Do I have another slide for it?
Yes.
Let's go back one. These are some of the girls in the lace-making classes. Now, if you have to be a refugee, displaced from your home, try to be a refugee in a room like this. Horton had so many connections that she was able to have both the Americans and French loan her their homes for these children. And that's how she established the colony. Later, Wharton toured the front, the military front, at the request of the French Red Cross to distribute supplies. And we'll take the next slide. And a side note here. As I say, she was so well connected diplomatically that she was not required to remove her hat in this identification frame. Such was not always the case. This is the Vermont writer and also war relief worker, Dorothy Canfield Fisher. Have any of you ever heard of Dorothy Canfield? And she's got this expression on her face because she's just been told to remove her hat. And as she says, she felt like a bobcat removed from her kits. Wharton was accompanied on these trips by her great good friend all the way on your right, the tall man named Walter Berry. And the two of them were driven by her chauffeur, confusingly named Cook, from Lee, Massachusetts, in Wharton's powerful touring car. Most cars were requisitioned by the French army, but Wharton was able to keep her car and get enough gasoline to do these tours at the front. Part of her tour led to military operations, and here she is. Here she is at a French military observation post just a few yards from the trenches and fighting. Wharton's position as a leader of relief and refugee enterprises was problematic. On the one hand, she exhibited a concept of noblesse oblige, that practice that those of us who, because of the circumstances of our birth or education, also inherit an obligation to help those who are less fortunate than ourselves. On the other hand, in her tailored dresses and her furs, she can easily come off as a patronizing Lady Bountiful figure. She had written that she hated aristocratic women who wanted to see the war front as tourists. In Wharton's phrase, quote, mixing the smell of anesthetic with the fragrance of perfume. But this photograph of her in her furs, smiling in front of a railroad boxcar with the word blessé or wounded painted on it gives me an unsettling feeling. The cover illustration from a French humor magazine of 1915 may seem mean-spirited, even cruel. Wharton had, after all, been asked to help, but here, the illustrator, Abel Ferré, presents her as a superior figure, looking down her nose and through her lorgnette at a destroyed French village. And this is the caption at the bottom, which I freely translated. Is that all there is? What's all this fuss about? Suffice to say, the attitude toward American relief workers in wartime France was never uncomplicated. It's a very slippery slope between wanting to help and being seen as a superior do-gooder when dispensing charity, particularly when it's not your own country. And for this section, finally, for those of you who watched the recent Ken Burns documentary of the Roosevelts, here's Edith Wharton with Teddy Roosevelt's youngest son, Quentin, and some of his pals. Quentin's on your right. Quentin was an aviator who was shot down and killed during the final months of the war. And she lost a number of people close to her. My second figure. This is the one you've never heard of. This is Nina Duryea, who lived in Stockbridge from 1920 until her death in 1952. She's roughly a contemporary of Wharton's. She's buried in the Stockbridge Cemetery. Her house was a renovated grist mill. And for those of you who have been to the theater in Stockbridge, Massachusetts, Berkshire Theater Group, this is just up the hill from the Fitzpatrick Theater, or the main stage. The house is now undergoing renovations, but it was the subject of a feature article in Country Life magazine in 1923. Her garden was designed by Daniel Chester French, the sculptor who did the Lincoln Memorial statue, with specimen trees donated by General Pershing and by French Field Marshal Joffre. And here's why. I'll let you look at her gravestone while I go forward. Nina Duryea was in Dinard, that's a city in northwestern France, in August of 1914, when refugees entered that city on their way south. She immediately wrote a poignant letter to the New York Times, which was picked up and republished in 2,000 newspapers and in Life magazine. American readers immediately sent relief supplies care of Duryea to France. Duryea War Relief was born. She credits that republication of her appeal letter with the raising of money and supplies to eventually help over 300,000 persons through her organization. We've never heard of her. Operating under the French official Department de Santé, Wharton's Duryea's volunteers dressed in the uniforms of nurses. And here they are gathered in the office. That's Mrs. Duryea right here. And Duryea described the effect of her charity's uniforms. Quote, "Our visitor's book contains many famous names And the depot is a pretty sight when the girls in their sky blue crepe de chine veils and pale gray uniforms hover among the maimed and ragged victims of war. All this stuff that I'm quoting from Duryea is from her unpublished memoir, which is held in the history room of the Stockbridge Library. Nobody's read it. Part of the exhausting work of running a war charity for both Horton and Duryea was raising money. It was not unusual for either one of them to write 30 or 40 letters a day. And these are handwritten letters, not simply dictated to a secretary and then signed. Now, Duryea made periodic fundraising trips to the United States. In Boston, for example, in September of 1915, while giving a speech at a hall, she was interrupted, and this is what she writes. At one point, Mr. Higginson, who runs the Boston Symphony Concert, sprang to his feet and startled the audience by saying that he was writing his check then and there, and that others must do likewise before the generous emotion would fade. Anybody here ever been involved in fundraising? Do it right now. She goes on to explain the name of her organization, Duryea War Room. Right here, I want to explain the apparent egotistical name of my organization. The matter was thoroughly discussed and several names invented, but it was the unanimous decision that the personal element was an important factor. The thousands of persons all over the world who have given their time and substance to help me as an individual, who had written and received letters from Nina Duryea, might lose interest by the loss of personal equation, should that individual become submerged in a conventional, impersonal organization. There are countless other committees which worked and made an impersonal appeal to the public, but as Mrs. Ditson said to me, to the giver, the personal note is far more cozy. The public knows the woman to whom they sent supplies and from whom they received letters, and it is to her and to France that they give their interest and help. And so it is to be Duryea War Relief. I feel like a patent breakfast food or a much advertised soap. Like Edith Wharton's American Hostels for Refugees and other large private American charities, Duryea War Relief distributed donated supplies of all kinds. With the organization's move to Paris, the first thing was to find a facility to house the charity and act as a distribution point. Her search was successful, and that's the picture we've been looking at. The depot, as she called it, was ours until the end of the war, and rent-free. Money was very important to Nina Duryea. She wanted everything to be given to her voluntarily. The next day, the clearinghouse sent great vans piled high with our supplies to our depot. Still clinging to my pet scheme of paying for nothing, I begged furniture from friends. Anna Fairchild presented 6 wooden chairs and a kitchen table, which furnished my office. We ranged the emptied cases along the walls in a double row, back to back down the center of the great domed hall, and on these shelves we emptied the contents in ordered piles. The next day we opened our doors and the poor victims of war flowed in. We had no system, no books, no order at first, just gave and gave. The poor can't wait for order to grow from chaos, but in a few days, realizing I knew little of business, I had sufficient intelligence to send for someone who did. Mrs. Behrens, a professional organizer, was in Paris. She received large sums for just such work as our situation demanded. One of her jobs was organizing the National Cash Register, so you can imagine her ability. Soon, this clever woman was on the spot working with us, studying the complicated work. For we do not specialize, as we have everything to give, from a church organ to old shoes. For 10 days, she studied, and then she disappeared. A week later, she reappeared with a perfect system of double and triple carbon books, and voila, we sailed on untroubled seas, with sails set, neat, orderly, and businesslike, and the precious soul never charged us a sou. Thus our depot is a busy hive from 9 in the morning until 6 at night. And on the scope of her work, she comments, although we clothed thousands here and sent cases all over France to Poland, Salonika, Belgium, and Serbia, to devastated regions and hospitals everywhere, our stock never grows less. Now, after, let me just see where we are.
Can you go forward?
Oh, here we go. I'll stay with this. After America entered the war in April of 1917, Duryea continued to work in France. But amid the uncertainty of whether the American Red Cross would gobble up her organization as it had others. The American Red Cross was the official relief and charity agency of the United States government after we dropped our neutrality and entered the war. Because it was the official agency of the United States government, only supplies going to the American Red Cross could be sent on ships across the Atlantic. And that meant that all of these private agencies run by individual women, which relied on shipping, could no longer count on receiving their supplies in France. In addition, the American Red Cross held a fund drive for 1 week in June in 1917 with a goal to raise $100 million. It was the largest fund drive in history, and it raised $114 million. With that money, the American Red Cross came into France, driving up the rents and wages of war charity workers, and making it almost impossible for small, private American relief organizations and charities to survive. By the end of the summer, more than 130 of the existing 140 private American relief organizations had turned over their operations to the Red Cross. The following year, the American Red Cross repeated its one-week fund drive, this time in May, and this time it raised more than $170 million. Now you can imagine, if you've been running a private charity with volunteers in France for 4 years, and somebody comes to you with loads of money and says, we understand what good work you've been doing, but it's now time for you to lay down your burden, and we will take over. So 130 organizations were wiped out in a 6-week period. Duryea survived. She was relieved when the French government gave, and then I'll pick up her words, our organization, the Department of Oi, and the Somme to care for, including 14 villages in the town of Roy itself. In the heart of the battlefield where the devastation almost wiped out our beautiful Picardy. It was the official recognition by the French government and saved Duryea Wormley. And while Duryea was setting up resettlement efforts in Picardy in 1917, she was gifted with an unusual assistant, and this is the boy. His first play on Broadway, a musical called See America Now, had just failed. He had graduated from Yale, but he was at loose ends. He knew he was going to be picked up by the Army. This is his draft registration card, and that is the drawing he had made of himself for his future wife. This is Cole Porter. During their time in Picardy, living in cellars, helping people whose homes had been blown up, Duryea observed a confoundingly colorful Porter. And this is a quotation from that unpublished memoir. He had appropriated for his use a pair of bright blue velveteen trousers from our store, also felt slippers and a green sweater. Thus arrayed for dinner, he felt that the exigencies of polite society had been filled, and while his exceedingly smart raiment remained in Paris, he was ready to die. Now, uniforms seem to have had quite an appeal for Cole Porter. Monty Woolley, the actor, was in Paris with the U.S. Army, and he recalls Porter strutting up and down the boulevards in uniforms ranging all the way from a cadet's to a colonel's. Porter, says Woolley, had more changes of clothes than Field Marshal Foch, and wore them with complete disregard of the regulations. One night, he might be a captain of the Zouaves, the next, an aide-de-camp. After the war, Porter wrote a song entitled, When I Had a Uniform. And it was for a musical review in 1919. And if you can make out the refrain, which I've printed on the right-hand side, the repeated part, it ends with the words, gee, I wish I could start another war. Kind of a grim reminder. Apparently, he wasn't alone. One of the most trying moments for the majority of female workers, according to the theater impresario Elizabeth Marbury, came not in the midst of their activities, but when they could no longer find the slightest excuse for strutting about in stiff collars, in masculine ties, in leather belts, and in brass buttons. Peace became infinitely more of a trial than war. I want to conclude this afternoon with some comparison between our two figures. First, as I say, they were near contemporaries. Wharton's born in 1862 and dies in 1937. Duryea is born in 1874, though her gravestone says something else. Died in 1951 in Fairview Hospital in Great Barrington, Massachusetts. Both Wharton and Duryea were awarded the French Legion of Honor for their war service. This is one of Duryea that I wanted to show earlier, and it shows me how she ages during the course of the war. I'll just take this moment to say that when she came to the United States in 1918 on a fundraising tour, her staff, her committee in New York, noticed that she did not look well. Finally, one of the committee members sent her personal physician, who examined her and said, "You have to take a complete rest." and Duryea, through the fog that she'd been in for several weeks, couldn't understand. And he said, in 6 weeks, you will be dead. So this is what this constant activity for raising funds, writing letters, did to these people. Another thing, both were divorced. Both Wharton and Duryea were divorced at the time of their war service. Both had been married to mentally unstable husbands. Against the advice of her future father-in-law, Brigadier General Hiram Duryea of the Duryea Zouaves, Nina Laurie Smith, at the age of 24, married Chester Duryea at Trinity Chapel in New York. The senior Duryea had warned her, do not marry this man. A separation occurred in 1904. In her testimony at the separation hearing, Nina said that her husband rarely allowed her to sleep in bed with him, ordering her to sleep on a window seat to an iron cot while he occupied the double bed. He admitted calling his wife a slob and a liar. He once forced her to attend the fancy dress ball when she was ill with the measles. On May 5th, 1914, Chester Duryea shot his sleeping father 7 times as the old man lay on a porch. So I guess in this case, father does know best. Both of these women retained their Berkshire connections during the war. Wharton wrote a novella called Summer, with a Berkshire setting, calling it her Hot Ethan, because the passion really grows hot in summer, as it doesn't so much in Ethan Frome. Duryea was aided in her war work by the wife and daughter of the sculptor Daniel Chester French. His studio is in Stockbridge near the Norman Rockwell Museum and is open to the public. Another point of comparison, both Duryea and Wharton had powerful patrons in France, which was very important. Let's go back a couple of pages. That's all right. Duryea's was a woman named the Duchess de Vendôme, who was the sister of King Albert, the King of the Belgians, who looked out for her. And Walter Berry, that tall man I showed you earlier, looked out for Ethan Wharton. He was an international lawyer who eventually became the head of the U.S. Chamber of Commerce in France. And that's why she was allowed to keep her car. That's why she was allowed to go to the front. That's why she was allowed to keep her hat on when she had her identification photograph taken. Wharton and Duryea met at least once and discussed whether or not to pay volunteers in their charities. And Duryea said, Mrs. Wharton told me she gave up working with volunteers and paid her workers, but she misses a lot of pleasure. This dear staff pays me by the splendid work they do. Final paragraph. Given what Wharton and Duryea achieved during the war, we were forced to ask, could they have run a company, even a modern corporation? Emphatically, yes. But those opportunities were not open to women in 1914. Instead, we are left with a record of their humanitarian achievements during the war. And that, I think, is a fine legacy in itself. Thank you.
little off topic, but you had said at the beginning that the young men in France were called up to go to the war, and I was wondering if you knew what the age group was that was required to go, or and if it got extended as the war proceeded and so many lives were lost, or just how that worked out.
The question is, what about this mobilization, a general mobilization in France in 1914? It was for men of the age of 18 to 40, 42. Unlike Germany, it did not extend as the war went on down into the children in the classrooms. You may remember from reading or seeing All Quiet on the Western Front, but those are young schoolboys who are going off to war. Well, that didn't happen so much in France. But the age cutoff was about 40, 42. By the way, on his registration form, the document, our friend Cole Porter asks to be excused because he has black feet. Any other questions or comments about this period?
Why has her, how did you discover her unpublished memoir? Because it sounds really interesting. And should we look forward to a publication?
I don't know that it will be published. I found out about it because she was one of a number of people who had run organizations, and I was very interested in what happened when these organizations run by private American women were taken over by the large male-dominated American Red Cross in 1917. And what happened is that they're lost. Nobody saved records of these small charities which weren't active when the United States was in the war. So I did look up some names. We have a couple of places where we look for manuscripts and archives on the internet. And I saw that there was an unpublished memoir in Stockbridge, Massachusetts. Soon after we got out of the college teaching business, we decided to move to Great Barrington. And Great Barrington is quite near Stockbridge. And I thought, well, I'll just go up there and see if this actually exists. And it did, and I read it. And it's fascinating. What she did was send letters to a friend of hers in England. And then about a third of the way through this stack of letters, she says, please save these, because I have no other record of what I'm doing. Please save these. So she intended to make use of them somehow, but got involved in other things. My friends are very patient in the back of them.
Did they know each other?
They met at least once or twice. Yes. Some of the relief organizations, as you might imagine, were kind of competitive, particularly in raising funds. These were not great friends. Borton was from a literary background, and while Dorier had published some juvenile novels, she wasn't of a literary type, Borton. But they did meet at least once.
Were they of the same social class? Was Nina Dorier in the same social set that Edith was?
She was close enough. There is a place in St. Augustine, Florida, New Jersey, called the Villa Zarenda. It was built by her father, who was an architect from Boston. And the Villa Zarenda is a beautiful home in St. Augustine. And she could dress very well. She had a good alimony coming out of this divorce, as you might imagine. But I think that they were not quite the same social class. Borton, if anything, was a little better connected. declaring this the cocktail hour.